Here now is Faith to Live By with Pastor Barber.
1,000 years before Christ, David said in Psalm 34 and verse 3, "O magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt His name together." And to lead us in doing exactly that is Rick Bowring singing "On a Rugged Hill."
On a rugged hill stood a rugged cross, and upon that cross there hung in shame God's beloved Son, Christ the lovely One, who from heaven to the sinner came. Calvary, rugged hill of sorrow, where the Prince of Glory died for me. Wounded, crushed and broken hearted, alone he suffered untold agony. Sinless, there he bore my burdens, that from sinful shame I might be free. Glorious day, he took my sins away on the cross of Calvary. On a rugged hill stood a mocking throng, scorning him who came to save the lost. But it was not in vain that the Savior came to redeem the world at priceless cost. Calvary, rugged hill of sorrow, where the Prince of Glory died for me. Wounded, crushed and broken-hearted, alone he suffered untold agony. Sinless, there he bore my burdens, that from sinful shame I might be free. Glorious day, he took my sins away on the cross of Calvary.
The Bible has the answer. You have provided the questions, and we search God's holy word, the Bible, in order to find the answers. Question number one: what exactly was Jesus weeping over in Luke chapter 19, verse 41? I suspect that the questioner is asking the question, was it over the bricks of Jerusalem, over the beauty, the splendor that was first century Jerusalem, the early first century Jerusalem, or was it over the people, the inhabitants? Luke chapter 19 and verse 41 declares, "When he," that is Jesus, "approached Jerusalem, he saw the city and wept over it." Certainly, it was the people. Indeed, there was a splendor to Jerusalem set upon a hilltop, and people would rise up to it, and as they would come over the crest of the hill, they would see the magnificent temple of Jerusalem, covered in gold, radiating in the sunshine. But in 2 Chronicles chapter 6 and verse 6, we have it. God speaking, I have chosen Jerusalem that my name might be there, and I have chosen David to be over my people Israel. So indeed, there was a definite connection with the splendor, with the particular place called Jerusalem. But the people came to trust in Jerusalem as an unsurmountable, that nothing could go on in that place but that God would not defend it. However, in Jeremiah chapter 7 and verse 4, God tells the people, do not trust in deceptive words, saying, this is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord. For if you truly amend your ways and your deeds, if you truly practice justice between a man and his neighbor, then God says, if there is a change of heart. But God was not concerned about the geography. He was primarily concerned with the position of the people's heart. In John chapter 4 and verse 21, Jesus tells the Samaritan woman that neither in Jerusalem nor in this place where the Samaritans worship is God to be worshiped, but he is to be worshiped rather in spirit and in truth. Geography is not the most important part. Now, Jerusalem was a vital part of God's economy because it was intended that it be there that the people gather to worship the Lord and to exalt him, that it be a place of meeting and of worship and of drawing near to the Lord. But here, Jesus, he had seen that this was broken, that the people were doing their own things, that the traders, they were buying and selling. And Jesus, he weeps that destruction is coming, that a time of horrific battle would be fought there. And he weeps that the people have lost God's intent for them in that they would come to draw near to God in this specific place, and God would work mightily within their hearts. Question number two, is purgatory a place for lost souls? And if so, can they still be redeemed by the blood of the Lamb? I regret to criticize any question, but there is a fundamental problem with this question, and that is that as we are dealing with what does the Bible say, we must plainly declare that the Bible knows nothing of what people refer to as purgatory. The Bible very clearly declares that there is a finality, there is a fixedness at death, and that neither shall there be a passing from one to the other, and that there is only two destinations following death. There is either damnation or there is eternal blessing. Both of those, eternal damnation or eternal blessing. And that now, this day, as we live and breathe, this is the opportunity that God has so graciously granted to us, that a choice, a decision might be made, that repentance, that we might call by faith upon the Lamb of God, and that we might know his forgiveness. Purgatory, that intermediary stage, which some church leaders came up with many centuries after the Bible, and then they sought to go back to the Bible in order to support their ideas. It is simply not in the pages of the Scriptures. The Apostle Paul said that for those who are trusting in Christ, for those who are in Christ, as he wrote to the Philippians chapter 1, verse 23, he said, to depart is to be with Christ, not to be in purgatory and hope that one day there will be enough prayers offered that we might go into the presence of Christ, but to depart for Paul, to depart for any believer in Jesus Christ, is to literally be in the presence of Christ, knowing it for all eternity. In Luke chapter 16, beginning with verse 9, Jesus told of the rich man and Lazarus, and that upon death, Lazarus, he went into blessing, and the rich man, because he cared not for the care of his soul, he went into eternal damnation. And Jesus plainly describes that there was a gulf fixed between the two, and that there was no passing from the one to the other. So the Lamb's blood in this world and now, as we live and breathe, there is that cleansing. But once we pass from life into death, then there is no more hope for the soul that is fixed for all eternity. Thank you for these questions. If you have a question, send it to us. Our mailing address is Faith to Live By, Box 426, Winnipeg, Manitoba, R3C2H6. Lois and Jan join with me as we sing at Calvary, and then Heidi Taves sings Beneath the Cross of Jesus.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free.
would want to remind you of two things that Faith to Live By Resources has prepared and that we are offering at this year-end season. The first is a CD, a brand new CD we have just released. It is in a sing-along fashion. It is called Our Favorite Hymns, 17 well-known familiar gospel hymns that I know you will enjoy singing along to. You will want to request a copy of this and perhaps a second copy to share with someone else. The other resource which we always offer at this time of the year is our beautiful scripture text wall calendar. You will also want to have a copy of this in your home, perhaps also in your office, should you still be at the workday each day. And it is sent free and postage paid. Many hundreds of these were sent out at the beginning of November, and now you will want to secure a copy of those which are yet left in our inventory. They are available for as long as they last, and then they are gone. Both of these are there for your blessing. Our mailing address is Faith to Live By, Box 426, Winnipeg, Manitoba, R3C2H6. You may also call us toll-free, 1-833-367-3852. And our website, faithtoliveby.ca, has a means of you requesting a copy of these things to be sent to you, or at least for the CD, you can download immediately the audio files, and they are there for your blessing and enrichment. Both the CD and the wall calendar are perfectly free. There is no charge for shipping or handling or anything of that sort. We simply want these things to be available to all who request them and that there be no hindrance whatsoever. Just before the message, we have Rick and Matt singing Calvary Covers It All. last half of the 1800s, the evangelist, the American evangelist, D.L. Moody, was preaching Christ, and yet he was drawing tremendous opposition. Some people were offended by his speech. He was not a well-educated man, and sometimes he would express himself in stuttering terms, and his grammar was atrocious. A second way in which he drew criticism was that he insisted that his meetings, his gospel meetings, not be held when people had gone through their day and they had leisure, perhaps in the evening time, in order to attend to spiritual matters. Moody insisted that his meetings be held in the middle of the day. And this brought criticism. It brought appeals from the business leaders because so many people were leaving the stores. They were leaving their places of business in order to attend Moody's meeting. But Moody had it right. He said, these people are attending to business, and there is no greater, there is no more serious, there is no more urgent business than the business of the soul. And so it was for this reason that he said, we need to come at these people when they are fully alert, when they are fully attentive, and we need to do business for all of eternity. I think of this in terms of Luke chapter 5 and beginning with verse 27 and 28. After that, Jesus went out and noticed a tax collector named Levi sitting in the tax booth, and he said to him, follow me. This is exactly what D.L. Moody was saying, not to follow him, but to follow Christ. The call was being made in the business hours, in those business hours. I think in my mind's eye, and here this is given so briefly in the account of Luke. Matthew had much to do. I'm sure he had his ledgers all spread out. I'm sure he had a line of people that were waiting to pay their taxes. I'm sure that there were other people who were delinquent in their taxes who he needed to track down and to make sure that accounts were settled on behalf of the Romans. I'm sure that he needed to be careful and watching over his shoulder for those who would want to harm him because they felt that he had betrayed the nation. Matthew had much to do. Jesus, can't you wait a minute? Can't you just hold off until I am at leisure? And then I will attend and I will hear what you have to say. But Jesus, he, without apology, without any rationale to go along with it, Jesus comes and he marches up to Matthew's tax table. And he calls to him, this is exactly as it is with you and with me. Whatever we are doing, wherever we are, Jesus, as the one who has created us and to whom we indeed belong, he comes to us and says, you have fallen into the hands of the usurper, the devil. You are dead in your trespasses and sins, and I have come to do business with your soul. I have come to redeem you out of death and out of darkness. I have come that you might have light and that you might have life in your soul as you have never experienced before and as you would never experience it from anyone else, regardless of what their sales pitch would be. Jesus comes to Matthew and he says, follow me. He comes to each of us and he says, follow me. What will be our response? Will we say, Jesus, please, I'm a little busy right now. Could you come back at a more convenient time? If we were to reply in such a way, we would indicate to ourselves, to the Lord, and to everyone round about us, that there are things that are more important than the Lord, that there are things that are more urgent than Jesus' call, and that is most certainly not so. We read and we congratulate Matthew for this, that And he left everything. He left everything. He walked away from it. He left everything behind and got up and began to follow him. And later that day, there was a great gathering at his house as he welcomed others that they might also come to know Jesus. Hear the voice of Jesus today. Hear the voice and that calls to you, follow me. And I would bid you arise and live in the power of Jesus. Arise in the cleansing of the blood of Jesus Christ. And know life, know it abundant and eternal, and also know joy in walking with him today and every day.
Yes, there's room at the cross for you.
Thank you for joining Pastor Barber today. Please watch for Faith to Live By again next Sunday at this same time on this same station. Until then, Faith to Live By prays that the peace of God will fill your heart and that the joy of the Lord will be your strength. Pastor Barber would love to hear from you. The mailing address is Faith to Live By, Box 426, Winnipeg, Manitoba, R3C 2H6.